welcome back for some more Torment Tires of Numenera. I'm the RPG chick. We got stuff here. I don't think we've been in these Fathoms before. Oasis Fathom, we went here in a mirror. Crefton Fathom. Village Fathom. Not sure. We just finished fighting the first cast off and the Sorrow and the first cast offs, well, the other cast offs that were with her, and those things, Corpuscular Maws and the Sorrow Fragments. Yeah, that was a pretty hairy battle. And now we're here in the calm of my mind. Let's go to the Oasis Fathom and see what's here. We're ultimately supposed to go here, the Path to the Resonance. And we've been here already. We've been here and here. I might take a look in these to see if there's anything different. But for now, let's go to the Oasis Fathom and see what lies in store. I can only imagine. We're going to be underwater. Almost. Interesting. New area.
On it.
I swam through it. I am swimming. Efimpy? Cool. We got an Efimpy. We got Jibra. Hail Jibra. This market was better before the Giash let visitors in. Oh, you mean myself? Efimpy, then.
Yes.
Yes, Efimpy. Another Jibra. What does this one have to say? Do you know the way to Perlandra Park? I seem to have lost it. Let's talk to this Efimpy. I don't know what we're doing here, or what we're going to be doing. This short, spare, lean-faced Jibra is so wrapped up in his work that he doesn't notice your approach. His multicolored scales look like they were patched together from an avalanche of shreds and scraps. He squeezes a strangely ticking device in his left hand, regularly checking the readings from his instrument. His expression changes with every glance, twisting from amusement to horror to disgust. Rhizomes are the answer, not trees, he mutters. We should never have believed in trees, roots, and radicals. They made us suffer too much. He looks up at you in sudden surprise. You're not a lacuna? Then we are linked, you and I, by life and memory and torment. There's that word again. Tell me, sister, what was the nature of your illusion? He watches the device in his hand as he awaits your answer. He thinks, if there is no root, then even our sire is a sibling. We are all one. What illusion do you mean? We suffer more in our imagination than in reality. All of our brothers and sisters have been drawn into this place. To keep us here while we await our destiny, the labyrinth constructs illusions from our fears, nightmares from our own self-inflicted torment. It takes the serenity of knowing oneself to free oneself. A shadow passes over his face. I was confronted by a scarred woman from my past. Were I not certain that I had already truly forgiven her, I would not be speaking to you now. Was it another cast-off? All of our brothers and sisters. The labyrinth constricts illusions from their own fears. He thinks, have I forgiven her or myself? What is the nature of our regret? Who are you? He looks up from his device and blinks. Who are any of us? I'm a part of all that we have met. I am a part of you that can hear what you're saying. Looking down, he gives the device two sharp taps. Efimpy, he adds. What's a lacuna? Why are we over here? Figments. Constructions fabricated from our collective consciousness. Take Loihan there, for instance. He points at a thin blue gibber nearby. Okay, that's what we were looking at. He is neither a cast-off nor a reflection. There may once have been an actual gibber merchant named Loihan. I don't know. Or perhaps he's an archetypal conglomerate. Regardless, he is a dream created entirely by the labyrinth. He doesn't even realize where or what he is. What is that device? Perhaps it also is an illusion. He frowns. I seek to understand the nature of our shadows. Speaking with others has been fruitless. So I observe. I measure. I hope. It is the latter that will be my downfall, I am certain. Can we free others from their illusions? All that consists is real, and the plane of consistency is the abolition of all metaphor. Some can free themselves, as I have. Some merely need be told that what they fear is unreal. The rest? He squeezes the ticking device again. It ticks faster, and he scowls. The rest are more difficult. I suspect that if one of them steps into the metaphor, with them, takes their hand and leads them out, they can be freed. But you must understand the nature of their regret. I have been unsuccessful in that so far. The abolition of metaphor. Understand their regret, step into the illusion with them, and guide them out. It is simpler to say than to do. Are you a reflection of someone I've met? Haven't you been listening? I am no reflection, no lacuna, no construct of your imagination. I am just like you, a cast-off, merged by the labyrinth, awaiting a destination. Farewell. We are rhizomes. Trees was too poor a metaphor. There's nothing to look at in here. Oh my. There's a whole bunch over there. Let me go this way first before I deal with all them. May or may not be the same chipper. I don't think I... Did I talk to a blue one like this? Ugh, not a tourist. The guides are that way.
Yes.
She agrees. Okay, so, yeah, here's this Loihan we were talking about. The water emerging from these tubes tastes like... Like what? Time. Strange liquids and even creatures sit in these jars and containers as though for sale. However, they are as immovable as the rock. Loihan stools. Is he a merchant selling things? The wiry gibra gives you a nod as you approach, his lips crooked into a friendly smile. Although his relaxed posture suggests a measure of comfort with his surroundings, his hand is wrapped tightly, almost nervously, around a tattered, leather-bound notebook. Inexplicably, the book seems unaffected by the water. Loihan Stoles, he says with another nod, census taker and demographer plenipotentiary, by appointment of the Giash. He opens his book, leaning it back so its contents remain hidden, and pulls out a quill pen. Might you spare a moment for a few questions? Is it really a good idea to use a leather book underwater? This had to ask. He glances first at the tome, whose marbled cover shows no sign of wear or tear, and then at the quill pen between his fingertips. After a moment, he shrugs. I suppose it could be a Numenera of some sort. Or maybe the leather is tanned from some sort of hydrophobic hide. He looks again from the book to the quill, and then back to the book. Strange, though, he concedes. Truth be told, I hadn't particularly thought about it. Can I see that book you're holding? You may not, he answers. Out of the question. Absolutely forbidden. He peeks inside it and snaps it shut again. As you can imagine, it is replete with sensitive personal information. The Giash vouchsafes the privacy of its citizens, and naturally, as the Giash's agent, I must do the same. So before I try to do any of this stuff in the census office, right? I'd be happy to answer your questions. Loihan nods excitedly, touches the quill to the page, and opens his mouth. Well, I suppose I should... He blinks and shakes his head. With renewed enthusiasm, he begins again. Yes, I'm sure the first thing to ask would be... He closes the book. Strange. Very strange. Well, maybe you have some questions for me? Oh, he didn't have questions. Efimpi says you're not real, just a figment of a collective imagination. The Jibba shrugs. As you can imagine, we census takers receive all manner of imprecations. I suppose this imaginary jab relates to the chief demographer's decision to transition us to statistical sampling methods. He waves a webbed hand, creating a slight eddy in the water. I assure you, every person counts, even me, he adds with a wry smile. I think there might be something important in the book. Please let me look at it. We can get to 85%. Let's try. Oh, all right, he mutters. But I'll need you to give it back to me as soon as you're done. He hands you the book. Far from being full of personal information, it is overwhelmingly empty. There are only 5 pages that aren't blank. Each is a solid color. Indigo, blue, gold, silver, and red. The tides. In the center of each is your familiar tattoo, like a deletion, an absence of color. Still, something about them draws your attention. Well, I guess I'll go in order, right? Examine the indigo page. Smells. Brackish water fouled with schist. Burning hair. Garbage rotting beneath the sun. It's you they're burning. Your feet are wet, but they're burning too. Differently. They're flayed, and the filthy salt water sets your nerves aflame. Why? Why are they doing this? Through the smoke, through the pain, you see a ruined land, poisoned, stripped, murdered. The natives want you to look at a stone tablet. They gibber about a contract graven in the rock centuries ago. A trade. A promise. It wasn't you who made it. You swear it. You swore it before, as the folk first pleaded and then howled about the living sphere they grew for you. How they sapped the land's health and drove the earth below the sea to quicken the sphere. Madness. Pain and madness. Your entire life. Pain and madness and fire. A few hours and nothing else. Then it will all end. It wasn't me. I wasn't even there. Death without reason. Punishment without crime. A legacy of ash washed away in a rising tide. These are cast-off memories. There's some familiarity to them, but that's nothing new in this place. Indigo again. Pain and fire, a dead land, and a dying newborn cast-off. The absence of sense and justice. Nothing more. It's horrible. Blue page. Knowledge and stuff. There's a time to question, and a time to obey. As a soldier, you know the difference. As a friend, even. Does she really mean to put her trust in this pedant? His study is adorned with trophies and accolades. A particularly large one commands its recipient for solving a complex fraud permeating the entire operation of the caravanserai. Vanity. The very organization of the room, not a clutter, but a catalogue, is a shrine to self-love. As an officer, you disappear behind your ribbons. You obliterate yourself. This puzzle-breaker has done exactly the opposite. Obedience. The order is given. Your job is to secure the services of a brilliant mind for whom no conundrum has proven insoluble. To ask, to wonder, to ponder. Those are tasks for another. Let the endless battle end. Let the dying stop. The study, the puzzle-breaker's trophies, and the weight of orders. Humility and humiliation are but a hair's breadth apart, but the thin line holds with discipline and obedience. I'm not sure if that has anything to do with knowledge and stuff. The gold page. Lying prone on a dune, the pale gray cloak and cowl blending with the drit, you are surely invisible to the distant caravanners. They can no more see you than they can detect the iron wind howling their way. They are ignorant of the line being drawn across their lives, as ignorant of the calm before as they are of the coming storm. Later, this moment will matter. Not just for them, for the wind can know no master, but what it sows can be reaped, its fruits fermented into toxins. Your brothers and sisters are hard to kill. Faith is hard to kill. Too many of them still revel in the bodies your father gave them, groveling for the half-chewed meat he's tossed away. When the flesh fails, faith will follow. No one loves a father who can't protect them. The drip begins to stir. The wind is coming, and with it, change. You give those who lie in its way no warning. And this doesn't seem like kindness and justice. The iron wind, the doomed caravan, and the dream of breaking faith with broken bodies. I wonder if these have to do with outcasts that we have met. Silver page. I mean, this might be a soldier. Yeah, a newborn cast off. So the changing god left, and they punished the cast off, of course, unaware that the person who did it is no longer in that shell. Absence of sense and justice. And then this one. Your job is to secure the services of a brilliant mind. Let the endless battle end. And then here, it's about the iron wind. Alright, silver page. Across from you is a fellow cast-off, a fellow officer, a fellow gambler. Eyes inscrutable, cards impossible to guess. The other players are broke, their company's bonuses, and leave, and even material passed away at the table. Tomorrow some will die for want of shield ciphers. Others will live because a captain drew a trump card. Chance. But iterate chance enough, and probabilities become inevitable. And the battle never ends. It's leave you're playing for you and your soldiers. Nearly every company is being sent to inXile to deal with the Chalcedon's assault. But one lucky hand, or one lucky band, rather, will have a milk run and a good debauching. Not yours, though. The cards in your hand are low. You know your bluff will be called. Tomorrow your grunts will be in the thick of it, and this lack-nimber will be playing nursemaid to an Aeon priest. Luck. Dumb, dumb luck. Grinding beneath it all, pride and striving. Again, you are struck by the senselessness of luck, the forks of fate by which a life is eaten up, the gears that grind glory to drit. The red page. You're singing. You were born singing. It shifts your senses away from the smells. It shifts your mind away from the shame. You like the doing of it. The escape from being trapped in your own thoughts. You've seen others that he made. Cast-offs. Strong and fast and beautiful. Human. Even a gibra, once. Swift swimmer. Smelling of burnt copper. To yourself, in the dark, you sing of them and their lives beyond the ghetto's bounds. You could leave, couldn't you? Any action, any change would surely be better. But perhaps not. Every song has its place. The space that holds its sound best. Where echoes and reverberations harmonize. This is your place. He locked you here, for better and for worse. You are your own shackles. So you sing. So many memories, so many lifetimes trapped within this place. The weight of it is overwhelming. Singing and longing and chains. Loihan seems happy to have the book back. Your book is basically empty. The only pages with anything on them are just marked with my tattoo. The gibbous gills flutter in what seems to be an expression of agitation, and he clutches the book to his body. Well, basically, eh? That's an important qualification. Then he shakes his head and groans. Very well, I confess. I'm not even the one who filled out those entries. I think they've been here the whole time. He groans again. The chief demographer will have my scales, I fear. But truth be told, there just doesn't seem anyone to interview. Odd, isn't it? He shrugs it off. He stays dry. Ugh. I look at it again. Yes, yes, Loihan says. Now that you've seen it once already, he hands you the book with its unchanged. Only 5 out of the hundreds of pages have any markings on them. The indigo, blue, gold, silver, and red pages with your tattoo blotting out the color in the center. Yeah, same. You're a census taker with an empty book that miraculously stays dry underwater. Can't you see that Fimpy's right? You aren't real. Loihan's inhuman face takes on a very human look that is part embarrassment, part relief. Ah, he says, and then with a pop he disappears. Huh. Okay.
Yes.
Now it's over here. The shimmering film appears to be as strong as steel.
All right.
Can't go up there? Oh, but we can swim through here.
Of course.
Oh. Talk to me, Orving. It's Tiber and Orving. I'm going there last because once I talk to Tiber, I'm going to get him away from here. Avi, please. Orving, I can't believe it.
All right.
I mean, if that's even how you say it. I'd take it back if I could. We'll talk to them in a second, guys.
Fine.
Or a few minutes, in any case.
On it. Yes.
Oh, yes. Please remain a respectable distance from the air breather. Jibber guard, jibber, jibber. Is imprisonment really best for him? He might be happier banished in the Lost Sea. Mazov. Oh, there's Mazov. Jibber guard. Get a close look at the air breather criminal. I guess they mean Mazov. Do male air breathers carry the eggs? Or is it the female? I can never remember. My son would love this. Another air breather? Come to visit your friend, I suppose. Look at those eyes. What do you think he sees with those? You should have seen the inmate last year. Now that was scary. I'm betting he'll escape tonight. You? You two look alike. Are you related? That's racist. Eh, you all look the same to me. Now that's really racist. I heard they killed his partner. Why didn't they kill him too? Stand back, ma'am. The fella may be in cage, but he's still dangerous. We can't talk to this guard? Have you seen the air breather yet? I guess I'm going over here. I'm just going to look at it. Huh. An obelisk thrusts from the platform like a horn, or a claw, or a tongue. Its parti-colored surface has a shimmer to it, and a slick texture. Not quite mineral, but not quite organic, either. The garish appearance belies something ancient, even wise, that seems to radiate from the obelisk, as if it were here from the beginning, or close to it, yet retained its youthful energy. 4 runes are carved into it, symbols of a civilization that predated the truth. Examine the obelisk itself first. You study the strange protrusion, seeking some meaning in its colorful walls and patterns. Like all Numenera, its exact nature is hopelessly beyond the ken of later worlds. But from your training, you have a basic sense of what it might be, some kind of psychic battery, storing a person's thoughts or memories or very self. Examine the runes. They are symbol shapes, something like a heavy quadruped in profile, a serpentine double curve, a two-tined comb, and a right-angled corner. But despite their simplicity, or perhaps because of it, their meaning is inscrutable. That word again, inscrutable. They could be simple glyphs depicting actual things from an ancient civilization, or symbolic ideograms, or phonemes, or senseless graffiti. They could be a warning or an invitation, a name or an epitaph. So goes man's attempt to instill meaning on the world. Touch it. As you lay your hand on the slick surface, the patterns move and swirl like living plasma. Actually, no, they aren't moving at all. It was merely a hallucination of some kind. You have a sense that this has happened before. This and more. A memory shifts and contorts through your mind, like the colors on the obelisk. It's just a matter of catching hold of it. Let's try to capture the memory. Yeah, we'll go all the way. Because I'd hate to miss it, you know what I mean? A broad smile spreads across your face as you feel the wisdom welling out from the stone. The two Jibra beside you, who helped scrap centuries of incrustation from the stone, sense nothing. From your satchel, you take a fleshy living artifact engrafted with various devices and crystals. You lay it on the obelisk and watch as one of the crystals begins to glow faintly, siphoning off the obelisk's psychic emissions. You and you alone will reap the bounty of its teachings. As the memory fades, you sense that the obelisk's energy has dissipated in the time you were lost in your own, more recent past. The thing that had tapped the obelisk is long gone, so whatever it meant to share has vanished into the ether. Oh, how sad.
Ready.
Though the obelisk no doubt could teach you many more things, you sense that it has gone dormant.
Yes.
Well, damn it. Alright, let's go talk to him. Mazoff. For an air breather, he's kind of handsome. What a compliment.